Thank you very much, and thank you for all those of you come out this evening. I'm much appreciated. I just hope I can live up to what you said then. It is true. I was born in Bendigo, and I now live in Castlemaine, and my entire life is spent coming backwards and forwards across to Ballarat and to Bendigo, and all places in between. In fact, this afternoon I've driven up from Geelong, and I drove my wife to Geelong as we look after our grandson tomorrow, and she doesn't want to listen to me talk about gold ever again, so she's staying in Geelong. And I drove up around, I used Google Maps, and I came up around Mount Buninyong, and I've never driven that little bit before, through Warren Heap and up to the Melbourne Road, and it's lovely country. And it is vastly different country to the country I drive through once you get past Aylesford to the granite country around Castlemaine and on to Bendigo, where it flattens out to nothing as it heads to Shepparton and the river. This is beautiful rolling country. And I think to myself, this is quite nothing to do with the subject as yet, but I want to say these things. I was thinking that when diggers arrived here to travel to the goldfields, the trek to Ballarat must have been more pleasant than the trek to Bendigo. You pop off at Geelong and you come up through these beautiful hills. I imagine the country has not changed all that much. When Thomas Mitchell first passed through and came across through Castlemaine and then heading back to Sydney, he noted from when he went up on Mount Alexander, he noted the open pastures and the very large trees. And many of those large trees are still there today, and the pastures are still very open. But it's rocky, and it's got little creeks and waterfalls and stuff. And it wouldn't have been as pleasant a walk as it was coming up here today. Of course, we've got the highway now, which is very nice. Certainly didn't have that in the old days. I just want to tell you a bit about why I'm allowed to speak about gold. And I think I am. I was born in a street called Chum Street, which was close by New Chum Creek. And I went to Specimen Hill Primary School and was transferred to Golden Square. And then I went to the tech school in Hargrave Street and went to the School of Mines Art School. So my entire life has had the nomenclature of the gold fields. Both of my grandfathers were mining men. One of them was an underground man, and that's him up on the top left with the moustache. And I have just found this picture. Someone put it up on Facebook, and it's there at the New Chum mine. And I publish books, and I've called myself New Chum Press. And through serendipity, all of this stuff comes together. It coalesces, and it makes me feel quite the authority on all this business. I feel proud to be able to talk about all this. This grandfather was born in England in 1875 and went to America with his family. He was a baby. His father was a miner. He was William Hocking. His father was also William, who married a woman called Grace Hocking. She didn't have to change her surname. I think they were cousins. I think there was a Methodist church between them, one street on either side, and they married and went to America. His father was also William. I just published his diaries, or the diaries of both of them, and I couldn't work out who was who. While I was writing it, I had to colour one red and one blue, so I knew what I was talking about. It dawned on me one day when I was, this bloke's diary, no, his father's diary. He was standing on the shores of Lake Erie in Michigan, looking at the grave of his mother. And I thought, I really do not understand how my great-grandmother is buried in America. But they went to mine copper. And there was a great diaspora of Cornishmen and women. There's a collapse of the tin mines. And they all got up and went to America, and they stayed for a very long time mining copper. He came out to Australia. I'm not entirely sure when, but I know that he went to the Kalgoorlie goldfields in 1890, saved every penny he had, come home, married my grandma, and then they went to New Zealand. He spent his life underground, virtually. There's a fabulous photograph of him and my grandmother and three daughters born in New Zealand on the Atari. I'm not showing you this because it's got nothing to do with what I'm here to tonight. But they've outside a little miner's cabin and it's covered in snow and the three girls in bassinets and in arms. One of my cousins went to Otago and stayed in a bed and breakfast and it happened to be that house. I find that unbelievable. My other grandfather is this tall bloke here, nonchalantly leaning on his mate. And it's my grandmother, whose own mother was the first white child born on the Avoca diggings. She's about 16, she married at 18. And that's his brother and his cousin. They're all on the Specimen Hill Methodist Sunday School picnic somewhere. When I was a kid, I'll go back to Grandpa Fred Cronin, who was born of an Irishman. He didn't ever go underground. His brother Dan was killed in a fall of rock in a mine in Bendigo when he was about 21 years old. But he spent his life as an engine driver with an oily rag and an oil pump in his hand, keeping the machines going that lifted miners and ore up and down. When I was a kid, this mine was still there looking like that in Bendigo, in the centre of Bendigo. It's called the Monument Hill Mine. There are now a little estate of houses on top of this. Not far from there, there was another mine which the poppet head was removed and it was a clear block of land and the young bloke decided to build a house and they got a digger in and they were scraping around until they hit a plug of concrete as big as two shipping containers. It had been used to cap the shaft and it took them about 3 weeks to remove this plug of concrete. And he built a house and he has kept the shaft in the middle of his house. They went down the shaft, put little lights down the side and have a plate glass floor in his lounge room, which I think is a charming idea. This mine was in Eagle Hawk, called the Sailor's Gully Mine, and I do believe, I was thinking about this today, when Sovereign Hill was built, they bought a poppet head mine from Eagle Hawk. As far as I know, and I could be corrected on this, but I do know a former mayor of Eagle Hawk, Councillor Roy, came to Ballarat with all the bits and pieces to give advice on how to put it back together again. This is a timber leg shaft, and I have a feeling that it's the one that is now on Sovereign Hill. I may be wrong, I'd love that to be the case. Nothing there now. And this Central Deborah mine is the largest extant mining complex in Bendigo. 50 years ago it was an absolute mess, and now it's a major tourist attraction in Bendigo. The thing about the goldfields itself, it attracted people. Well, you all know these stories, and that's why you're here tonight. You know, probably, when I was a child, I thought I knew Bendigo, I knew the history. My grandfathers were miners, I knew gold was found. But I actually didn't really know anything about how it all came together. Publicising the gold fields in Australia was big business all around the world. It's the same thing in Britain, in Scotland and in Ireland. The newspapers were carrying illustrations promoting the gold fields as a wonderful adventure. This is a very early map of the creek in Golden Square. There were a series of water holes and the first gold was actually found here in this creek bed. There was a shepherd who had a little hut there on the outskirts of what was then called Ravenswood Number 1 Run. The shepherd was well known for putting on sham fights. If anyone came through, and quite a lot of people came through this part of the country, driving sheep through, going from station to station, he would put on a little display. And he got known as Bendigo, because the champion bare-knuckle boxer of all England at the time, the Muhammad Ali of his day, was known as Bendigo Thompson. His real name was William Abednego Thompson, and that comes from the book of Daniel. King Nebuchadnezzar cast three people into the fiery furnace. They prayed to God and they were saved. And their names were Shadrach, Meshach and Abednego. The boxer was born of triplets in Nottingham and only two of them survived. But they were also given middle names, Shadrach, Meshach and Abednego. Bendigo himself was known, he liked fighting and he became quite athletic and put on boxing shows. And he's a bit of a lad. He was involved in cockfighting and all those sorts of things and a little bit of gambling and misbehaviour. But he was physical and he decided to enter competitions for boxing and rose to become the all-time champion. He only ever lost one fight in his entire career of something like, I think, about 28 fights across a number of years. And they were fighting for big money. The last couple of fights were £200, which is the equivalent of at least 4 years' salary for the average working man. He was very athletic. He danced around the ring. He'd pretend to fall over and lie on the ground if it looked like he was going to get beaten. He'd make up little rhymes about his opponents. He'd taunt them, make them really angry, and then fight for, they'd go up to 50 to 90 rounds. And he only ever lost this one fight. The chap nearly choked him, got so angry with him. He had him on the ropes and he was squeezing his neck a little bit too tight and they called the fight off. And this other fellow, who was much larger than him, won the fight. They had a return fight a little while later and Bendigo won that one. But he was really the Muhammad Ali of his day. In fact, in Nottingham itself, there is a photograph at the library of Muhammad Ali coming to the place where Bendigo used to train. And of course they proudly display that because he was just one of those big names of the boxing world. So this chap liked putting on display fights and he was given the nickname. So you can imagine someone there on the gold is going, "Hey, you think you are Bendy, hey? You think you're Bendigo?" And when the gold was found, people would come into the port of Melbourne and ask the question, "Well, where do we go? Where was the gold found?" And they'd say, "Well, you go up past Mount Alexander," which was named then, Major Mitchell named it Mount Alexander, "and you go all the way up there and look for Bendigo's hut on Bendigo's Creek." And that is the naming of Bendigo. People say things like, "Oh, I always thought it was an Aboriginal word," or "it was round the bend I go," which just sounds really lovely. But after considerable research and scanning newspapers, there is an article in the newspaper at the turn of the century that pronounced, "Now we know the truth about the boxer and the chap from Nottingham." One of the things about Bendigo, they were very patriotic. In Ballarat, not so, because you have a predominance of Irish Catholics who come from a particular part of Ireland and, in fact, who are very closely connected to the Young Ireland movement. Whether they were participants, but they know what was going on. In fact, Peter Lawler, and I'll come to this later, that Peter Lawler's brother, Fintan Lawler, was one of the Young Islander rebels who died in Kilmainham jail. And this is before Eureka. So for Lawler himself, he's very much indoctrinated into those sectarian attitudes of the Young Islanders who wanted separation from Britain at all costs. There were three major protests against the licence fee that the government brought in. Two reasons. One of them was to try and get people to go back to work, to leave the diggings and go back to their work on farms as shepherds, to bring in the crops, to go back to the factories, to go back to the port, get back on the ships and take them back to England, because the port of Melbourne was a forest of masts and you just could not get people to go back and crew the ships. Sailors would turn up on boats, obviously, and they'd leave one bloke on board and they'd all hop in a rowboat rowed ashore and disappear up to the diggings and then make enough money, fill their pockets and come back to Melbourne and hop on the boat and go home. And it's the predominance of sailors' gullies in every goldfield. It's like, who are those blokes? They're sailors. Oh, over there on the sailors' gully. In Bendigo, we've got a place called California Gully. We call it Cal Gully. I don't think anyone really has ever thought, what does that mean? Well, I suppose you've got the England and American Hotel on the corner, but it's where all the Yanks went, to California Gully. In Castlemaine, on December the 15th, or it could have been the 5th, or it could have been the 11th, just so happens that this particular engraving says it's the 15th, or other reports have other dates. A great meeting of diggers was held to protest the licence fee. And they say 14,000 people turned up outside of Shepherd's Hut, and we know where that is in Castlemaine, in Tewton. It's not there anymore. There is a flag that flies on the spot. A couple of years ago, we put up a sculptural thing there on the spot. And I was working with the council who said, this is the place to put it. And we Rotary funded it, and it showed the digger's flag, and it was about 5 metres high, cut steel, a bit like what we've got out the front here. And within 3 days, there was that much protest by people who used it as a walking trail, and it disturbed their view of the valley. And DNRE suggested that either have it removed or I could be fined $200,000 for interfering with a native park. And I said, but this is a gazetted road. Well, we're going to DNRE actually wants to take that road over and make it the park. And I said, so it's an aspirational park, not an actual one. And then some official turned up and suggested that it come down or I could face jail. So we just took it down. Now stand beside the highway, which is a much better place, because it's something we didn't think Vic Roads would allow us to put it beside the highway. But if you know people in Rotary, they know everybody, and you just ask a Rotarian to find out what they can achieve. So one of our Rotarians knew someone in Vic Roads, and it was stitched up beautifully. It's not corruption, no money changed hands, just stuff gets done. I would have liked to have been on this spot, and so would a whole group of other people, but it was one of those times where ideas come together that don't coalesce. Speeches were made on this day, and there are records of everything that was said, and they all vowed to stand together and fight the government. I love this, that groans were the cheers for the Daily News, but groans for the Herald. Obviously, the Herald didn't support the diggers. Things were fairly primitive in the early days, so here we are, right at the beginning of the rush. I think there's a certain amount of ingenuity at play here. Ironbark Gully and what extends to the northwest of Bendigo was really the richest gold fields of them all, on the Bendigo field, that is. It was mostly alluvial. In the very beginning, people could just walk by and pick up gold. I mean, this story is told everywhere. The same thing happened in Ballarat. I was reading an early newspaper report from a couple of young men who went out looking for a lost horse, and they sat down to fill their pipes and have a smoke, and one bloke just looked down at his feet and picked up a nugget lying on top of the ground. So they said, well, we'll come back here later and have a good look around, because they had to find the horse and take it back to the owner. So they cut a little blaze on a tree so they could find their way back. And they came back the next week, only a few days later, and found the whole area look like this, and all the trees had been cut down, so they couldn't find the tree that they'd actually marked. It's a massive amount of gold taken out of this area. Once they started doing reef mining, that is, erecting poppet heads and going down, it was just extraordinary, the amount found there. And it's all gone. Every poppet head, it's all disappeared. What has been left is broken land that's of little value to anyone. Gradually, developments are going in, but it's just gravel and rubble and shale and broken rocks, piles of refuse from the quartz mines. And it's a bit sad to see, because it's actually quite beautiful country. In Bendigo, the government turned up pretty quickly and established this camp on what is still known as Camp Hill, on the rise overlooking the creek. So a number of churches have been built up there, the Church of England, the Presbyterian, the Wesleyan Church, all straddle this rise. The art gallery is on one side of Hugh Street, and there is a sporting oval and an extant poppet leg sitting up there, which was moved from the creek bed up to the top of what is known as Camp Hill. The primary school there is still called Camp Hill. And this is roughly where the art gallery in Bendigo sits now. This chap is Commissioner Panton, and I think he's the reason that the Bendigo rebellion didn't end up in an armed battle. Panton was not a soldier, he was a civil servant, and he'd been appointed to take control of the Bendigo diggings. His attitude was completely different to a military man. He actually listened to people. He heard what they had to say and said, "I'll see what I can do about it." He was a Scotsman, which I think says a lot about what is different about Bendigo to Ballarat. Bendigo had a predominance, people who were leading the rebellion and the agitation, there was a predominance of Scottish Chartists. And they had argued with the British government long and hard since the Jacobean Rebellion. And they were constantly pressing this notion of a vote for every man, the opportunity to buy land, an opportunity to invest in the place where you are making your living now. And Panton actually understood all this. These people at that time were starting to ask, why can't I buy land? Why can't I invest in this place? The squatters who ran the government, and wasn't really a government like we know it today, it was a legislative assembly of wealthy landowners who came together rather like having a meeting with the commissioner, the lieutenant governor of the colony, like sit around and decide what is the best thing for themselves, really. And the best thing for themselves was to stitch up leases for all the land for a considerable amount of time and not bother about these people at all. It caused an enormous amount of rancor amongst the ordinary people. The other thing that really annoyed them was having to wait all day to get a license. Some of them write of having to go back 3 days in a row to wait for the military men to issue them with a license. They paid good money for that, a lot of money. And a lot of them decided really not to bother and would do their very best to avoid having a license. Of course, you get found without one, you'd end up being fined £5 or spend a week helping to clear the roads. And there's a wonderful story in a Bendigo newspaper of a young man who's been brought up before the commissioner, and he said, "Well, what would you do if I ran away? Would you shoot me?" And they're about to fine him £5 and or send him on the road. They said, "Well, of course we wouldn't shoot you." So he just tipped his hat and said goodbye and ran, and went through the trees, and a couple of troopers chased after him, but he disappeared very quickly. But the licensed hunts were vigorous. In Ballarat in particular, I've got to move on a bit because I'm probably talking far too long, and we'll get to that in a moment. But in Bendigo, these are the main players. So it's Commissioner Panton on the left, This chap was known as Bendigo Matt Lachlan McLaughlin. He'd come up from Tasmania, police magistrate. He was like an elephant. He never forgot a face. If any digger was brought up before him that he recognised from Tasmania, he would kick them out. He'd say, "You have to get out of Bendigo or you'll be in prison." He didn't want any vandemoniums in Bendigo, and he was very hard on anyone who misbehaved. The chap here at the bottom is Captain Ball, who was the first commissioner of Bendigo, then transferred to the Forest Creek digging. He was well-liked, and when he got to Castlemaine, Forest Creek, he also was well-liked there. And in fact, he became the first resident warden for Castlemaine after Eureka and everything changed. There's a street there named after him, and he was highly regarded by the local people. Dr. Downs Owens came from up around Beechworth. He was on the diggings up there and had a lot to say on all of the gold fields. He ended up becoming a parliamentary representative, but died quite young. George Thompson was a Scottish chartist, one of the great leaders of the Bendigo field, and Captain Harrison, who had been a sea captain and a squatter himself, but also joined in with the fight against the government. And this fellow, William Dixon Campbell Denovan, this painting is from the Bendigo Art Gallery, one of the few to be honoured with a lovely portrait, was one of the leaders who kept going for many years. He had a novel way of attracting people to his meetings. He would light bonfires on rises around the city and let people know that a meeting was on. He arranged a big meeting in Bendigo after they'd taken up the petition. This is the Bendigo petition. They say more than 10,000 people signed this, although the petition as it exists today, which now looks like this, only has 3,000 names on it. A large number were lost in the gold robbery around Kyneton. All the McIver diggings, all the names that were signed from McIver through to White Hills were on the escort that day and were lost. Funny thing is that there is no graphic of the Bendigo petition. There were graphics, illustrations, which were published in Britain. There are illustrations of every part of the Eureka battle and the lead up to it. There are illustrations of the Castlemaine goldfields, and then I drew this the other day, an illustration of the Bendigo petition, because nothing exists. I'll just flip through these. We have a record of the flag, which is given to us by William Howard, who was an eyewitness to the big march that took place in Bendigo. The symbolism is clear. It is that the working people are demanding justice. And we are all together here in Australia. So the petition was rejected by the government, by the governor, and the diggers in Bendigo were pretty unhappy. So they again formed together and they marched up New Street. It was a pretty ordinary day, 26th of August, 1853. And people came in from all across the diggings, along the creeks, just fed in like ants to a honeypot into the centre of Bendigo. And they marched up New Street and presented themselves once again to the commissioner and said, "We are not going to pay the licence fee and we want it reduced to 10 shillings. And a number of diggers went in to see the commissioner with 10 shillings in their hand and were prepared to say, "This is all I'm paying." And they were all prepared to be arrested. And of course, the government wouldn't do that. We're just too many, and what would they do with them anyway? And then after that, they all decided to cut up red ribbons and tie them in their hats as a protest and wore them to let people know that they were all in it together. And the protests continued. But in Bendigo, there was no battle. The same thing kept going until here, a year later, a meeting was held on Bakery Hill. It was a beautiful painting by Noel Kernahan of diggers at the meeting, diggers and their wives. And I think this is the other thing that differentiates Bendigo to Ballarat. There was a lot of families here by that time in Ballarat. A lot of Irishmen with their wives and children. And I talk about there being Irish Catholics here, but it is fairly evident that a lot of the Irishmen came from what was called then Queen's County in the centre of Ireland, known as, think of it now, it's gone out of my head, Abbey Leaf, and Peter Laylor and several other of the leaders of the miners here in Ballarat all came from that area. We went there a couple of years ago searching for stories about Laylor and his background, and we went to the local tourist information centre and asked if they could point us to his birthplace. And we went down country roads, and I'm sure we didn't find it. But why, as we're driving into the little town, we crossed the Fintan Layla Bridge. And Fintan was Peter Layla's brother. And I'm trying to figure out, I think he was what then would have been called crippled. He wasn't a fit person. And he was part of the Young Ireland movement. And they were defeated by the British, I think now, 1849. And he ended up dying in Kilmainham Jail. So, you're from Ballarat, you know all these stories about the burning of the Eureka Hotel and after the death of Scobie, and Bentley was let off by the commissioners, people gathered outside the hotel. A young person threw a rock at the lamp across the door and the place caught fire. And really the battle started from that point. This is Laylor at his brother Fintan. And I think the day that Laylor got up on this stump, the other leaders had gone, Humphreys and gone over my head in a moment, had gone to Melbourne to again talk to the governor to try and do something about the license fee and the unrest that was here in Ballarat. All the governor did was send more troops to Ballarat. And he was on his own, and he stepped up onto this stump and proclaimed the digger's oath. It is where everything changes. I mean, there's a battle in shoes from this moment, but it is where people actually stand up proudly, fly the flag and say, we will fight to defend ourselves. I think for Laylor, all of Irish history came down on him at that moment and said, you can do this. You're the one. You know how to do it. Your family have been involved in this. His father was a parliamentarian. He knew what he had to do. I mean, when in Ireland, it's quite staggering when you drive around and I came across a little plaque in a country road, and it said, this is in recognition of what's his name, Holt, who was transported to Australia. And he was sent to Castle Hill outside of Sydney and observed the Castle Hill riots, although he maintained he never had anything to do with them. He observed young men being flogged almost to death, their skin ripped from their backs. He watched the murder of the prisoners on Castle Hill, and that was a time when they had banded together to fight their oppressors and rushed to Sydney and erect a victory pole in the middle of Sydney to say, we are all now free. Well, I'll tell you that I went to Enniscorthy, which was the home of Dan O'Connell, And there is a hill there called Vinegar Hill. And I climbed to the top of Vinegar Hill to have a look around, and it's just a hill. And the village of Enniscorthy is there. And the Irish had been chased to the top of the hill by the British. And the British were all around the bottom. And they thought, no, they won't attack. They won't run up a hill, and they certainly won't attack before dawn. That's what the British did. When Laylor, in the Eureka stockade, I don't know whether he did this or the decision was made by a small group of people, that the password to get in and out of the stockade was Vinegar Hill, most of the Englishmen went, this is an Irish fire. They just walked away. Because Vinegar Hill was the catch cry of the lost battle of the young rebels of Ireland at the Battle of Enniscorthy. The British just came up over there and slaughtered them. And so they did it again. Before dawn, up the hill. I reckon they must have been fairly miserable, because we know that there was a thunderstorm that night, and they sat amongst the diggers' tents in the rain all night, waiting for the order to attack. You'd be going, oh, come on, get on with it, you know. And when they said attack, oh, thank God, let's do this. From Ballarat, you must know all these stories. Here are the rebels in the dock. All the names are there. Poor old John Joseph is an African-American who, although the American consul had made sure that most other Americans didn't get held in custody and have to face trial, he didn't worry too much about John Joseph, because obviously he was the wrong colour. Not much changes. Here in Ballarat you have this, a great flag. It's a symbol because it is a flag. The digger's flag is a banner, much like Union banners. At the time of Federation, it was thought that this would be the flag of Australia. In fact, a flag maker in England kept asking the government, is this going to be your flag? We've knocked up some samples. What do you think of it? And the government then, by and large, was being run out of New South Wales, who said, we're not having anything that looks like a flag from Victoria. Certainly not one that represents the rebels of Victoria. And so that was not the flag that was ever used. I think it's quite a lovely flag. It's only that thing in the top left-hand corner which could be replaced with anything. This is the first flag of Australia. The red ensign. I argue with people sometimes. I go and speak about these matters, and there's always someone who tells me I'm wrong. Everyone knows that all of our diggers fought under the flag of today. And I say, well, how do you know? Well, it's in the photographs. I say, show me colour photographs of diggers on Kokoda Trail. I said, a red flag and a blue flag will end up looking exactly the same. In fact, more diggers fought in the First War under this flag than under this one. They were given this to put in their backpacks because they weren't really an Australian force until during Gallipoli. Birdwood was asked to form a fighting force and the Anzacs were born. They fought under an Australian name at that time, Australian New Zealand Corps. I just want to tell you one more thing which may interest you. It's about Bendigo. I talked about the boxer. This is him. He was so famous, they did coloured lithographs of him. They did engravings of him. There's a portrait of him in the National Portrait Gallery in London. It's a beautiful painting. We're trying to honour him at the moment. A local author and I are doing a book called Go Bendigo. It's aimed for school children to try and get people to recognise where this name comes from. The author did an excellent idea of putting those two words together, and throughout the book she writes things like, he was doing this and the people cheered him, go Bendy, go, and I thought, oh, how good is that? And these are the ladies who are there finding the first gold, and the shepherd by the hut. months. Obviously, it'll sell well in Bendigo. Whether it sells in Ballarat, I don't know. I just show this. We found this the other day when I had hair. I've been mucking around with this story for ages. When Geoff Kennett put commissioners in charge of most regional councils, they were in Bendigo for some time, and they decided to change the symbol of Bendigo from the poppet head, which had been used for a long time, and they were going to use a lion's head as a symbol of Bendigo, which I thought was really appropriate because Bendigo is well known for its lions, its tigers, its giraffes, and other African animals. They took it from decoration, which is on plaster parapets of buildings of the Victorian era. Well, that's great. Drive through Carlton, there are little lion's heads everywhere, especially where Italians and Greeks live. They have them all on their veranda posts, you know, and out the front of their houses. And I've got myself known for, wrote to the Bendigo Advertiser and said, I'm really unhappy about this. We need to look at our history. The Red Ribbon Rebellion was a big thing where people stood with one another and demanded change. And they eventually won that change. After Eureka, Commission of Inquiry was held, and almost all of the demands that Chartists have been making from the British government for the past 50 years were granted. Democracy was actually born here. As is democracy in the British Empire was born here in Ballarat. I've said this before, and people go, oh no, everyone knows that Britain is the birthplace of democracy. Well, no, it's not. It's the exact opposite. Britain fought long and hard for hundreds of years to stop people having a voice. Oh, what? I wasn't going to say that. That just made me think of something else. We're talking about the voice at the moment. People are still asking to be heard. Heard about the things that matter to them. And so this is what happened after Eureka. Democracy was granted to the people of Victoria and Australia. They had the right to vote. They had the right to buy land. The two most important things that exercised their mind at the time. And they had the right to live free. It didn't matter who your family was. It didn't matter how much money you had, although it obviously always does. There were some people in Bendigo and Ballarat who made so much money, and this is what upset the government more than anything. He actually said, these people don't know what to do with money. You know, they waste it. Well, I think if you've been dirt poor all your life and suddenly you've got 4 weeks' wages in your pocket and you're 18, 19, 21 years old, what are you going to do? Go to Melbourne, have a bit of fun, come back and get some more money. But there are enough people who invested. Bendigo, a lot of businesses were built very early on those gold fields. My wife's family, her grandfather, great-grandfather, built a tannery in Chewton, and he made parchment for British Parliament and employed 80 people. They came up for the diggings and then did what they knew best from the old country. There are people who came here. It amazes me that people came on ships with printing presses and fonts of type with the idea of, I'm going to set up a newspaper. I think you're packing up in England, you go, oh, I better get this one. This is Caslon and Bodoni. That could be needed in Australia. And you pack them up and the big printing press that no one can lift, and you take it up and you drag it up to the diggings and set it up in your tent and start printing a newspaper one sheet at a time and sell it for a penny. That's entrepreneurial. Thank you for paying attention. I've rambled, I know, and shown you lots of things and lots of things that you already know, although I bet none of you knew about this bloke. We went to Nottingham to the library, and unfortunately, this was 11 years ago. My granddaughter was born in Leicester, which is quite close to Nottingham, and we drove over to the library. It's before anything was digitised. And I said, what have you got on Bendigo, the boxer? And they went, this is it. What do you want to know? And it was full of every newspaper article written about him since his day boxing, and photographs. And this engraving, which was in a little plastic bag, and I said to my wife, would you just stand there between me and the librarian, and I'll get my camera out and go click, and copied it. So, because otherwise, I said, can you give me a digital copy? Oh, no. No, we haven't got the facilities to do that. I said, well, how am I going to get one? Oh, I don't know. So I have one. Sometimes you have to do these things. Now, it's on the web.